Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, Senator John DeFrancisco is with us for the first time in 2015. How are you, Senator?
Doing well.
Happy New Year.
And Happy New Year to you. I'm looking forward to a new session with a Senate majority, so upstate will be represented better. And I'm very excited about the election outcome and what it means for this session.
Yeah, so today is the first day of session, and usually that's followed by the governor's State of the State message. Because his father passed, it's going to be 2 weeks later.
Correct. Traditionally, we open the session with a legislative session, both the Assembly and the Senate organize, basically formally elect the majority leader, swear in the secretary to the Senate, and several other administrative situations. Then normally someone comes from the governor's office, somebody comes to tell who the senators are that are going to greet the governor, and same with the assembly, and then they leave the session, go tell the governor the legislature's ready for the message. And this is the first time since I've been here, and this is my 23rd year, that this something like this has happened. So what will happen, we'll just organize today, and then the governor will give his State of the State on the 21st. And so it's a little bit different, but it's still exciting, especially for the new senators. There's 10 new senators, seven of whom Republican. That's by far the most since I've been here.
So give us an idea how the first few months are going to play out.
Well, basically, January, in order to get a bill on the floor to vote on, it's got to get through through committees, various committees in some instances. So right now, the bills are being put in order to ready them for the committees. And once the committees are organized, because the chairmanships haven't formally been announced yet, then they start having committee meetings, and the bill comes out on the floor eventually. And so the floor, what's going on the floor is not going to be much, and it isn't ever in January. But eventually, at some point in January, there'll be some bills ready to vote on. And then we go roll right in. The governor's budget message is going to be given on January 27th. That's important for me, assuming I'm still chairman of the Finance Committee, in that that kicks off budget hearings. So the public knows what the governor wants. The Senate and the Assembly, the Finance Committees of both houses, held hearings. So anybody within reason, I mean, there's a limit as to how many can testify, but those testifying about that specific part of the budget. One day it may be education, next it may be higher education, next police, public protection. So that is what happens virtually the whole month of February. And the hearings are long and detailed, but it gives everyone ideas about the budget and perspective on it. And then when we finish that, the budget hearings will take place with the Senate, the Assembly, to try to come up with their own budgets, and then come up with a joint budget that hopefully the governor will agree to, which has got to be done by April 1.
Now you talk about hearing from people from all different sectors for these hearings. Last time you were on the program, you asked your constituents what they would like to see accomplished, and they can still give you that input.
Yes, online they can give it to me if they got the mailer, which they should have, and they still have it. They could do that and mail it in. But I'm on my website that's on the screen right now that they can click on, and there's basically 10 questions and about different pieces of legislation that are going to be, I think, at least discussed this year, whether they ever get on a calendar or not. But I want to just see what the constituents think, and that always helps me frame my opinion. So we got a head start on it by getting that mailer out in December.
Right. So what about your priorities for this year?
Well, the big one that everybody's talking about is the $5+ billion of money that was received from settlements against banks. So the state of New York is $5.5 billion that they never thought they would have, at least not in that magnitude. And what that means is, I was quoted in the newspapers calling it the feeding frenzy will start in Albany. Everybody will say, oh, now you got the money, our particular thing has to be prioritized, whether it's education, whether it's infrastructure work, whether it's senior citizen issues. Everybody's got their priorities. Now their argument's going to be, I know for sure, every group, well, you can't say you don't have any money anymore. It's there. It's just a question of getting it to us. My preference has been, since the minute I learned of this windfall, is that use it for infrastructure, roads, bridges, sewers, water lines, in view of the fact that, especially in the major cities, and actually also in the towns and villages, there's roads that have to be fixed. There's water lines that crack every day in Syracuse, mm-hmm. and I'm sure in Auburn as well. And this is a one-shot deal. Get these things done. It's not like next year you got to pay for the same thing once you did it. It'll be many, many years before that next maintenance might have to be done if you do it right. Same with roads and bridges. They've been neglected for the last 5 years, and a big part of what's going on in roads and bridges is the Tappan Zee Bridge. Mm-hmm. The governor still hasn't notified anybody how he's going to pay for it. But my main thing is, number one, infrastructure work, one-shot revenues for one-shot projects, not like education. If you put money in, big money in, what are you going to do next year when you don't have that extra money? Mm-hmm. You're going to have a hole, and then you end up having to make cuts, and that kind of system makes no sense. But we do have an extra surplus from the normal operations of state business. The revenues are coming in better than anticipated, so there'll be money for more school aid. But this money should be done for one-shot projects.
At the end of...
And this you're going to hear over and over. And it's got to be regionally balanced. Mm-hmm. Okay, if you're going to take a chunk of $2 billion and put it down to the Tappan Zee Bridge down in downstate, we've got to have a corresponding amount of money as downstate, because we have as many problems, if not more, with our infrastructure upstate.
And doesn't the current road and bridge plan expire this year?
It does. And in the past, we used to do five-year plans for the Metropolitan Transportation Authority down in New York City, and five-year plans for roads and bridges is upstate. And they always used to be balanced in dollars spent by the state. And we got away from that when the Democrats from New York City took over everything. They forgot about upstate. Now we're back in the mix, and we really want to get five-year plans for both of them balanced as far as the amount of funding.
Okay. At the end of the year, there were two major long-awaited decisions that were made, and that is for hydraulic fracturing and the locations where casino gaming is going to be.
Well, the casino gambling, I mean, everybody can always, the voters voted for casino gambling.
Right.
So whether it's going to be gambling or not, the voters decided that. Mm-hmm. So the question became where they're going to be located. Now, I voted no on casino gaming, basically because there were separate deals with the various Indian nations, which precluded some areas of central New York from opening a casino, you know. And I didn't think that was fair. If there's going to be casino gaming, everybody should be eligible. But in any event, in addition, there was this commission that was appointed to name up to four casinos. I was kind of shocked where the casinos were ended up located. One's just another upstate casino, very close to the Turning Stone, the Indian Casino. I'm not sure how that works. I don't think there's that many gamblers that are going to go east one day and west the other day to be financially feasible. But somebody studied it. They made that decision. The one I was really shocked at, there was no fourth casino, the one that was hoped for in the Southern Tier. And the Southern Tier in the Binghamton area, you know, that's probably the lowest economic viability in the state. And they not only didn't get the casino, but now talk is that they may look again at it to see if the casino is going to get it. But also, they were banking on fracking.
Right.
Because they got a rich deposit in that area, and the locality wants it. It's not that the locality is pushing against it. So I was getting into the second issue, fracking. I was not surprised. I didn't know what the governor was going to do. My guess would have been that there'd be a pilot project in the Southern Tier, and that pilot project would be heavily regulated and heavily inspected and observed, see how it worked. It's just too much economic activity to just say no. And then how it goes there in a community that really wanted it, then you can decide whether it should be expanded in other areas. That's what I would have done, but the governor didn't ask me. So the thing that's kind of amusing about both decisions is the governor indicated that, you know, the commission was appointed to decide, basically washing his hands. You know, he had nothing to do with it. Same thing with the fracking decision. A new health commissioner comes in, all of a sudden he's the expert on fracking. And to say that he had nothing to do with the decision is, anybody that knows the way the governor operates, he micromanages everything, everything. So to suggest that he left total trust and total authority to these groups, to me, is impossible to believe. So we'll see if things change in the future, but that's where things stand right now.
So they said there were too many red flags for the hydraulic fracturing, but in the budget talks, you're going to try to probably figure out how to build up the renewable resource industry.
I guess, and we'll just see. The starting point is what he's going to recommend, and we'll see that on January 27th, and then we'll have hearings, and we'll see what the general consensus is, and hopefully do the right thing.
There was no special session at the end of the year. Everyone talked about legislators getting a pay raise and coming back to vote on that. Explain how that plays out.
Well, the legislature used to determine the salary of judges and legislators. And you cannot vote for a salary increase in your term of office that you're currently in. It's got to be for the next legislative body. So over the years, basically, that meant that in December, after an election, the legislature that's still in would make a decision for the next year, which is a few weeks off, next 2 years, what the salary is going to be. And the difficulty with the legislature is, for years we were tied in with the judges. So when the judges got one, the legislators did, and that was the way things were done. In any event, I think there's 15 or 16 years the last time there's a legislative pay increase. And every 2 years in December, there's always speculation whether there's going to be a pay increase. I answer the question whether I'd vote for a pay increase probably 10 times, I don't know, since I've been in the Senate. And I keep saying, look, we don't know if it's even going to get on the calendar. But I think after 16 years, probably something should be adjusted. A few years ago, the judges went ballistic, and we ended up appointing a commission to set the salary increases. And they finally got theirs maybe 3 years ago. So my guess would be there'll probably be a commission appointed this year, can't affect this year or next, and possibly ready for the following year for that. Now, the other thing about the pay increase is that I really think that if you take it out of the hands of the legislator, have a commission like the judges, and just hopefully get around this issue a little bit, because it's always such a hot issue for really little reason in my mind. Mm-hmm. The county executive on Onondaga County may get a $37,500 pay increase this year to bring her up close to what the governor's earning. Mm-hmm. Now, there's same stuff is going on now, but she had an increase a relatively short time ago, not 15 years. So it's not. Last thing, I knew I was thinking of something, I couldn't think of what it was. The governor was asking for campaign finance, so-called reform. He wanted public financing of campaigns. And if we did public financing and a few other things, then he would allow a pay increase. He wouldn't veto it. Now, I said that if that's the deal, I'm not voting. No, I'm voting no. I will never vote for something like that, because we're talking about corruption all the time. Mm-hmm. To me, that's the ultimate. Mm-hmm. You will get more money to serve in the Senate if you vote for this that I want, that you really don't want. Right. To me, that's a quid pro quo. That's getting money to vote a certain way. So for him to even suggest it based upon his theory that he's cleaning up Albany and reforming things, that's outrageous. So, in any event, as academic, as I told the reporters, it probably would be when I ask these questions, and we'll hopefully get over that issue somehow this legislative session.
Yeah. So we have so many things to talk about. We're going to have a new education commissioner. I also want to get your input on your cell phone for soldiers drive, but we are out of time today. So next week, come back and we'll get some more information from
you. That sounds good.
All right.
I'll be here.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For more information, defrancisco.misenate.gov.